Hi everybody, it is Wes again with Pikes Peak Trades. Happy to give you the second video of this weekend for trading ended February 5th, 2021. This is entirely focused on gold, silver, and the miners. And as I had indicated in last weekend's video, the two things we really need to see as catalysts to get these metals and miners going is continued weakness in the US dollar and real interest rates as judged by the difference between nominal yields and the inflation rate to become increasingly more negative. So we need to talk a little bit about where we stand on that. This is a more zoomed in chart of DXY that I use as the proxy for the US dollar, and zoomed in from what I had showed last week, in that this week we did see a pop out of that declining resistance line. And a little bit of concern that are we actually seeing a reversal, a bullish reversal in the US dollar? Let me show you what that looks like now on the daily, because this is really going to give you the levels to look for. It's now popped cleanly out of this downward channel. It is above all of the crucial moving averages, but still below this key level. So this 92.474, by the way, that Elliott wave would give the highest probability of a move. If the dollar breaks that to the upside, we're probably not going to see what I'm projecting in big moves in metals and miners. I would point out, although this is a little zoomed away, you can still tell here that this is an outside bearish candle. It closed just right above the 8-day EMA. And it closed right at a pretty typical wave 4 fib. So this could be the reversal at a fib and also by pattern that we're going to need to see that break back down in these next coming weeks and then eventually get back down within this channel. So this would have a false breakout look in order for us to reach these targets, which I think is going to be necessary for metals and miners to really have a run over the next few months. Okay, so that's the US dollar. Now, what about real interest rates? So we can judge nominal rates by looking at what bonds are doing. So let me show you here a daily chart of the 10-year Treasury note all the way back from early 2020. This is about a year's worth of information. Take a look at that chart. And now let me take you to a weekly chart of GLD. You're going to see it's not that much different. So you see a big spike up, and then you see some sideways consolidation, and essentially since August, downtrend, which is exactly what we've seen in gold. So what are we looking at? A clear correlation between bonds and the metals. Now remember that nominal yields, interest rates, work inversely. So what has been happening? We've been seeing increases in yields. And what I'm suggesting needs to happen is a reversal. So is there a chance that we're going to see a reversal? Are bonds going to get a bid? Would interest rates come back down? Again, this is a little zoomed out and hard to see. But here we do have an outside potential reversal bar on Friday. We did see yields intraday turn lower, bonds spike higher, and you could argue that's possibly a bullish hammer. So if we're seeing reversal in USD, if we're seeing a reversal upwards in the 10-year note, that could indicate that we could have the catalyst moving in the correct direction to really get these trades going. Okay, so now let's focus on the charts. I use GLD and SLV as proxies because I don't chart or trade futures. And it is an ugly weekly candle on GLD. There's no way around it. It closed right on crucial 50-week MA support. So the line in the sand is just really close. It's at 166.03. And when I talk more about GDX, I'll kind of talk about what could happen if that breaks and we didn't get a 1-2 setup. Okay, now on the daily in GLD, I had talked in last week's video about the positioning here on Friday, and what I was anticipating was going to be what I call a jump the creek gap up move. That is actually exactly what we got on Monday. And I got maybe a little bit overzealous and excited in thinking that that was the kickoff of the run. And then we know the rest of the story. If you're into metals and miners, the rest of the week it just got slammed down until a potential lower rail hit. So the accuracy of this lower rail is very good, multiple hits along it. That could have been the support that could spring, along with what I've just talked about of reversals in the USD and yields, to get this back going in the positive direction. Okay, now, I'm not a huge follower or big believer in conspiracy theories, but it is pretty evident that the big bank players out there do not want to see precious metals going higher. And it's a pretty obvious reason why banks like JP Morgan and others would reinitiate massive short positions last week. It's because strength in metals, traditional historical money, indicates weakening confidence in their fiat system. And that's a huge battle. I think a bigger battle than most of us lay people even really understand. But this is a big deal. And in what I've studied from past historical bull runs in the metals is the big boys can hold the trade at a primary degree level back for a while, but they can't completely stop it. And that's, I think, where we're at, that this has been held back for a while, but I think the conditions are there for them not to be able to stop it. But as you can see, with the USD, with bonds, with gold, we are at crucial levels, and this coming week is going to be decisive. Okay, now into the short term on GLD, and I can talk again about that horizontal level. It's still maintaining what I think can count as a bullish 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up into a three-wave correction down into that low on Thursday within a reversal and a bounce into Friday. I'm going to show you GDX here in a little bit and indicate to you why it made a lot of sense for GDX to make a lower low, GLD not. But if the old adage that the miners lead the metals is true, there is an alternate count that would have this as kind of the dead cat bounce that would move below 166 on GLD. Now, by my longer term counting, it can do that as long as this price does not break. So this is the absolute red line drawn. If GLD breaks 158.53, I will say that the bullish thesis is dead, that I will not be looking to recount this. And I would offer at that point that we're not going to be seeing these kinds of moves in metals and miners. So we really, really are at critical decisive levels. Okay, let's look at SLV. SLV is in much, much better shape, and we're still paying close attention to that extremely important long-term pivot, decade plus, in the $26 area. We saw a push up in August that was immediately sold down, a push into it in January. We saw the break that was Monday of this week that got me really giddy, thinking we're on our way towards $50. And of course, we know what happened on Tuesday at the daily. So we get this push, this is the weekly into the daily. Here is that massive push. And then just that massive short selling fueled paper dumping collapse on Tuesday. And the rest of the week was spent trying to pick up the pieces. Now, low volume perhaps after that has me leaning a little bit bullish. And a hold of the 21-day EMA, I think crucial support. So this is still maintaining a very bullish nested 1-2 count. Obviously, way healthier than GLD. But that's been my projection for a while, that silver will vastly outperform if we get the bullish resolution in the early part of this cycle. Now, if I'm right and I'm talking to you in, let's say, 2 to 3 years, that's going to flip on its head. That's when I think you'll see gold outperform. But for now, I hold in the possibility that support held this week. We break this pivot in the $26 area, maybe with a move up and a back test, and I think we could see a huge run. I think we could see a 50% increase in SLV, a 50% upwards move in silver within the month of February. Okay, now I had been talking about GDX, comparing it to GLD, and we did get this week, we did get a lower low than the weekly low that occurred the week of November 23rd. So how did it count differently and what might have been the clues to anticipate? I'm still counting it as a double zigzag. We've got two zigzags of three with another three in the middle. But on GDX, it was this move that was really the one that did have me a little doubtful. It is very, very difficult to count this move to here as an impulsive wave. It does count much, much better correctively. I have it as kind of a complex correction here with a move in, and then we've got kind of a failed expanded flat. That's tricky, but I think a clear five waves down into what I think is a very appealing double bottom area on GDX. And we had a nice bounce and run right back up to the top of that channel. So is it positioned again, just like it was Friday the previous week? Can we get a gap up and out, but this time the back test doesn't break down? And that's what I would suggest to you needs to happen. Otherwise, we're going to continue with a GLD breakdown to new lows, and that's going to make GDX and the other miners to new lows as well. Okay, so that's kind of the overarching picture of the conditions, the fundamentals, looking at some of the catalysts, looking at GLD, SLV, GDX. Now let's get into the names I really like. So start you off on this screen with one of my favorite silver juniors. This is Abra Plata. And we're going to see it in a nested 1-2 setup. There's another name on this list that's also there. These are the setups that you would want from an Elliott Wave perspective on any name, that we have an initial IPO top, a primary 2 pullback, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2. I think a name like Abra could possibly triple or more into, let's say, late April into May. It's got the Elliott Wave set up to do it. It needs to obviously strongly clear the previous week's high at 0.438, which is a huge move. You know, that's already, we're talking about a 33% move, and obviously just continue to run past its previous all-time high. But the setup is there for a name. Some of these juniors will vastly outperform the other majors that I'll show you on some of these charts. So let's get into those. AG, the one that gets the most attention here on the weekly, a very negative week, a huge Monday, spent the rest of the week crashing and trying to find support. From an Elliott Wave perspective, nothing was violated. And I liked the weekly close right on this rail. So not only did we get Elliott Wave conditions that are okay to count, we saw a little bit of closing support, enough of a bounce. And so on AG, I'm keeping a more conservative, well, it's conservative for the miners, target as my primary. But my original bullish one that I presented to you on Monday on the big move has not been violated. And it is still entirely possible that we see AG move even more aggressively up than what I'm showing you here in black. On the short term, this wave four is valid all the way above this wave one high. So the invalidation level is 12.22. If that is traded into, this bullish thesis is off. Core. So you're going to see that core, even after a beatdown Tuesday, Wednesday, is up 4.31% and above all of its crucial weekly moving averages. And just right at this kind of this rail area that needs to be cleared. Now, core does not count as cleanly, and I've debated back and forth on how to count this, finally kind of settling on what would be like an expanded leading diagonal for minor one. If I counted it differently, the ultimate fibs would still be about the same that I'm projecting here, that we see at least a doubling by the time the meat of this move is done, I think in quarter two, 2021. On the short term, I loved how it got back above the 200 period, 15-minute MA. Now, might we see a little bit of rest back before the next move up? It's totally possible that we can. That would be a sub-degree. In this case, it would be a minute degree, one up, two down. I'm not going to get too involved in these short-term squiggles until I see us approaching these farther targets much more into the future. So FSM, like ABRA, another pure nested 1-2 count. Why I like it? Because this count is pretty clear. Once it can get decisively above this significant pivot in the mid sevens, 750 to 770, can hold that, I think it could also quickly double. So I do have some upper rail resistance connected to some the previous two peaks in the mid $12 to $13 range. I think it could get there in, let's say, the next 6 weeks. And then an extremely bullish target that's not out of the realm of possibility by any fib extension that we would say would be too crazy. On the short term, you can see that nested 1-2. A pretty deep minor two, but still within Elliott wave rules. And a close-up look, unlike CDE, and next you'll see Hecla, it didn't get back above, but that's where I think it's going next. We get back above this blue trend following MA, and I think we could see a quick move in the month of February. So Hecla. Zoomed out a little bit more here so you can see the importance of this double rail setup, really just railroad tracks, two rails here, and up over 7.5% on a week where it was up nearly 40% Monday and down well over 20% on Tuesday. What a recovery. Love how this active rail is holding at the low. And it's still in position to challenge this rail set. That's its breakout area, just right above $8 in order for it to get into a place where I think it could double or maybe a 2.5 times move. There you see it, zoomed in more onto the weekly. Still in a good Elliott wave position. And into the daily, a proposed path. Remember that impulse waves are always five waves. So from that low, we would be looking for a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Again, like these other names, could this double in a month? The suggestion is yes, because it nearly doubled in 4 days from the end of January into February 1st. So what I'm projecting here is not out of the realm of what they have already done and what could be what is typical of miners to do when they really catch fire. We'll finish with the short-term look, and it's still in a good position. Now, could we have had some small squiggles, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and will we get a little bit of a a pullback Monday. If the general market does pull back, you're going to see the miners pull back with it. That would just give you, if this thesis is convincing enough, a great entry to play some of these targets. So I hope you've been able to see kind of from a fundamental and a technical view. It really is a crucial week for my thesis here, my bullish thesis. I remain in the position that if this will resolve to the upside, this is the outperforming sector. The Elliott wave suggests it. Historical price movements suggest it. The ingredients are there. Can the big boys set up against it, stop primary degree trends? My suggestion is no, but we need to see what happens this week. And I think next weekend's video will probably be pretty consequential in me being able to communicate how we're heading towards a resolution in this direction. So hope you enjoyed this as well, in addition to my Stocks A to Z general stock market video. Thanks for the likes. Thanks for subscribing to my YouTube channel. Send the word out and look forward to a really, I think, highly important week, especially in metals and miners.